one each of it. Good morning. Let us worship God this morning. Our first hymn is number 173, Sing to God New Songs of Worship. Boys and girls, young at heart people, great to see you all this morning. And you all remembered. What did you remember to do? You all remembered to put the clock back. Hands up if you can tell the time. Hands up. Yeah. So, boys and girls, I'm going to show you some times, and you can tell me what you think of when you see this time. I don't know where. Is this a good place to stand over here for this camera? So, there we are, the little numbers, little hands at 9 o'clock. What happens at 9 o'clock? I think I had the right answer there. School, you like school? Yeah, it's good, that's good. So that happens at 9 o'clock, and let's try this. We'll put the hand up to, that looks like 11 o'clock. What happens at 11 o'clock? Yes. You've forgotten. It's nearly break time, isn't it? Does anyone have a little coffee at 11 o'clock here? Yes, some people like having their coffee. Have you heard of your 11sies? Yes, we still have our 11sies. Let's try another time. There we are. How about that? What happens at 2:45? What do you mean you've forgotten? quarter to ten. Let's try it, church. Thank you very much. Thank you. Yeah. Try to think. Now, what about this? Maybe not. Maybe not. Let's see. 8 o'clock? 8 o'clock? 8 o'clock? Nothing? No? 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 Will we try a bit more? We've done 9 o'clock. Oh, sorry, 8 o'clock. Oh, get ready for school. Oh, that's good. That is really good. 8 o'clock, ready for school time. What about bedtime? What about bedtime? Will I try this out? Yeah, I'm going to try. See. 11 o'clock.
An hour to midnight.
An hour to midnight, yes, an hour to midnight. Hands up those who would be in their bed by 11 o'clock. I should think so, for goodness sake. I should think so. And let's try another one. What about getting up? Let's go back. 10 o'clock, 9 o'clock, 8 o'clock. Let's try that. Hands up those who are in their shower at 7 o'clock in the morning. 4. No. Boys and girls, I try to be in my shower at 7 o'clock in the morning, and I try to walk the dog by then, and I try to be at my desk at 9 o'clock. Anyway, this morning I thought I'd talk very little bit about time and the history of time. We've been keeping time for a long time. Does anyone know how we first kept time? I'm going to tell you. Sundial. We looked after... Oh, I thought maybe we got a picture up there, a sundial. So after the sundial, then the Romans had water clocks. Water clocks? Have we got any water clocks? There we are, water clocks. And they lasted for a while, and different months would have different size of water clocks. And then mechanical clocks. Mechanical clock, that might be a mechanical clock. Oh, there we are. That's a cuckoo clock. Saw plenty of these, tell you about that later. And then, round about 1840, something very interesting happened. The Great Western Railway Company got fed up with different times and different places, and in 1847, standard time was invented in this country, and it was linked to London time, and that became Greenwich Mean Time. 1908, the Canadians were first to put the clock forward, to make sure we got a little bit more light in the morning. But it's very interesting, boys and girls, why really we put our clock back, because it's fall back, spring forward. The first country to do it in Europe was Germany in 1916, and they did that in order to save coal. And then everyone thought, that's quite a good idea. So we followed suit as well. It's very, very important as you grow up to be able to tell the time. But boys and girls, sometimes when we speak about time, we say different things. We talk about wasting time. We talk about saving time. We talk about spending time. But what I want to say to you this morning is, do you know, our times are a gift from God. Every single day. And if we treat time as a gift from God, then we're more likely to use our time well. There's a lovely little verse in the Old Testament. Teach us to number our days that we might have a heart of wisdom. Boys and girls, every day is a gift from God. Every day is a special day. And I think God wants us to use our times well. Let us pray. Lord God, we bless you for the gift of time, for the special moments you send us. Help us to use our times well in your service and in the service of others through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I'm going to continue, boys and girls, with your hymn, If I Were a Butterfly. If I Were a Butterfly. So, ladies and gentlemen, information's in your hands. It's always an encouragement to read them and keep up with our family news here in Alloway Parish. Looks as though we'll have a fairly traditional week this Tuesday. Parent and toddler group, quiet time of prayer. Parent and toddler group again on Friday. I think I do get a mention on Wednesday. Yes, the friendship group. Now, ladies and gentlemen, this is open to everyone. I know by tradition the ladies tend to attend, but I'm told it is open to absolutely everyone. And gosh, who's going to be their speaker this week? It's the Reverend Neil McNaught. Extraordinary. Don't let that put you off. Now, I have to say, ladies and gentlemen, providing I can find it, I have in my time down in Ayrshire done a couple of talks on the windows, the story of the windows. So if you don't know the story of the windows, and even if you do know the story of windows, you can come along and keep me right. We look forward to seeing you on Wednesday. Can I say also our shoeboxes need to be returned today. Our thanks to everyone who's already filled and returned one or more, and that comes from Linda, and we do thank Linda for all her work on our behalf. So it is with regret I do have announcement of a death within the congregation, that of Mrs. Wilma Bain. Miss Wilma Bain, and can I say Wilma's service will be on this coming Thursday in the crematorium at 12 noon. But to our family, we extend our deepest sympathy. And these are, I believe, all the intimations. And to bid a warm welcome on a cold day to everyone to church this morning. It's lovely to see you all. If you are a visitor, we hope you feel at home. And this is the moment in the service. As always, I would encourage you to exchange the right hand of fellowship and your name with those who are sitting round about you. Please do take a moment to do that.
In the quietness, let us settle our hearts as we approach God in prayer. Let us pray. Our God and Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning to praise and adore you. Thank you for your promise that where two or three are gathered, you are there in the midst. We are overwhelmed by the wonder of your creation. We are inspired by the mystery of life. We are amazed by the beauty of your world. So we come before you in awe and wonder, humbled before your greatness. Loving God, we are thankful for your constant presence, for the healing of your love, for the challenge and inspiration of your word, and for the community of your church. Renew us and refresh us, enable us and enliven us, challenge us and change us in our worship, in our lives, and in our service to you. How deep is your love and how boundless your mercy, that no matter how terrible our mistakes, how shameful our secrets, and how often we stumble and fall, we can pray to you for forgiveness. And in you we find our salvation. We confess that sometimes we are lazy. We lie back and let things slide. We neglect what we should care for. We confess that sometimes we give in to harmful urges. And sometimes we lash out and hurt our loved ones. We confess that sometimes we are greedy. We buy things we do not need. We grab for more of what we already have enough of. We confess that sometimes we are self-righteous. We call others insensitive or uncaring, yet we fail to recognize or acknowledge that we are guilty of exactly the same faults. And we confess that sometimes we forget you. We wander around in the darkness. We do not seek and move towards you. Forgive us, dear Father, for our sins and our shortcomings. May your peace and loving presence occupy our hearts right now, throughout this day and throughout the week ahead. And now, Father, hear us as we further pray, using the words that Jesus taught us, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now I'd like to invite Carol Kennedy forward to read our scripture readings this morning.
Let us now hear from the Word of God. Our first reading is from the Old Testament, from Psalms, Psalm 126. This can be found on page 623 of the Pew Bible. Psalm 126, a song of ascents. When the Lord brought back the captives to Zion, we were like men who dreamed. Our mouths were filled with laughter, our tongues with songs of joy. Then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy. Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like streams in the Negev. Those who sow with tears will reap with songs of joy. He who goes out weeping, carrying seed to sow, will return with songs of joy, carrying sheaves with him. We will now sing hymn 555, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. Our second reading is made up of two parts found in the New Testament, from Mark chapter 10, verses 46 to 52, and then John chapter 1, verses 1 to 5. These can be found on page 1015 and page 1063 of the Pew Bible. Mark chapter 10, verses 46 to 52. Blind Bartimaeus receives his sight. Then they came to Jericho. As Jesus and his disciples, together with a large crowd, were leaving the city, a blind man, Bartimaeus, which means son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Many rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stopped and said, "Call him." So they called to the blind man, "Cheer up, on your feet, he's calling you." Throwing his cloak aside, he jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. "What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus asked him. The blind man said, "Rabbi, I want to see." "Go," said Jesus, "your faith has healed you." Immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus along the road. Our second part of our reading is from John chapter 1, verses 1 to 5, page 1063 of the Pew Bible. The Word became flesh. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not understood it. Amen, and praise be to God for these readings from his holy word.
Thank you, Carol, for reading for us this morning. It's now my pleasure to invite forward Malcolm McNeill, who will lead us in our prayers of intercession.
Let's pray together. Our loving Father, we thank you for your goodness to us, for the relative peace and tranquility of this beautiful place, when there are so many places that are troubled and hurting. Our world seems engulfed by wars, famines, intolerance, and man's inhumanity to man. We pray for the innocent children needing medical attention and food in the Yemen. We pray for compassion and the creation of humanitarian space. May the nations move away from short-term political expediency and take pity on those who suffer. We remember the refugees and asylum seekers attempting to travel through Mexico to the USA. Almost all the families in the U.S. can trace their heritage to earlier migrants and asylum seekers. And we do pray for a lasting and just solution to the problem. We pray for those caught up in the attack on the Tree of Life Jewish synagogue in Pittsburgh, for the families of the 11 people killed, and many others injured, both physically and mentally. We remember those in the security and aid agencies, often overwhelmed by the scale of these crises. We thank you for the beautiful autumn colours, which speak to us of your hand in creation. Open our eyes to see your creation. Help us to be thankful for the many ways in which you undertake for all of our needs. Help us to be grateful and not take your daily provision for granted. We confess, Father, that we're troubled and perplexed by the Brexit crisis as we seem to stagger on towards March 2019 without a clear way forward. So we pray for wisdom for our political leaders at this time, those inside the government and those on the outside or in the opposition. And we ask for integrity in leadership, moving away from short-term political gain. And we pray that a just and sustainable way forward will be found. We pray for all those in our church and youth organisations now planning ahead for the festive season and the celebration of Christmas. Please bless their planning and work as they seek to ensure that young people understand that Jesus is the reason for the season. We pray for those in our congregation who are caring for loved ones who have long-term chronic health problems. Thank you for all they do, and we pray for your presence with them at difficult times when tiredness and frustration threaten to overcome. Help us to stand with them and do all we can to help and support. We remember those who are ill, facing extensive treatment or surgery, and those facing an uncertain future. Comfort and protect them, we pray. We ask they will feel the assurance of your presence with them. And be close to those families mourning the loss of a loved one at this time. Help us to stand with them and support them in difficult times. Our loving Father, we ask all these our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Saviour and Lord. Amen.
Thank you very much, Malcolm. We now continue our service by singing once again, "I Watch the Sunrise Lighting the Sky."
It's a great morning for that hymn, because I don't know if you saw the moon last night. It seems closer than ever. And then the rich beauty of this morning, a feast for our eyes. They say 70% of our perception, how we understand our world, is through vision. You blink on average 4,200,000 times a year. Eyes have 2 million working parts. Your rod cells have 2 light-sensitive cells in the retina. There are about 125 million rods in your eyes, which are necessary to see in dim light. And if lighting conditions are suitable, they say that a human eye can see the light of a candle from 14 miles away. The eye and the brain, of course, work in conjunction with each other. And I think that's when I get into trouble. At times I'm less worried about my eyes and more worried about my brain. Just recently I had a should-have-gone-to-Specsavers moment. The other day I started to clean the inside of the car with a cleaner. I thought it smelled a little bit funny. It turns out the car cleaner which I was using was in fact weed killer for the garden. In my defense, both to be found in a kind of greenish spray. The good thing, I guess, I'll no longer find weeds in my car. I love that sign at the optometrist, if you don't see what you're looking for, you've come to the right place. I think they call the slight loss of sight presbyopus. It means old eyes, and you're right, I suffer a little, just a little, from presbyopus. Eyes are precious. Many of you understand that. We're very gifted and blessed to have a hospital that can aid us with our vision. When you don't have your eyes, I guess then you lean on your other senses. And I say all this, of course, as I run into our lectionary reading for today, which is one of the encounters of Jesus with a blind man. It's towards the end of his journey. Jesus is heading towards Jerusalem. He's at Jericho, a very prosperous place, but it's clear, even in prosperous places, the poor are to be found. It's a man called Bartimaeus. Let's just try and imagine it from his point of view. Perhaps he hears footsteps, the talk of travelers. Perhaps he smells wagons loaded with dates and olives. Jericho, as I've said, was a prosperous, busy place. The unmistakable sound of the crowd. Jesus, the miracle worker by reputation, the worker who has time for the least and the last and the lost. Bartimaeus knew his great need. He couldn't see. Perhaps Jesus was his last or greatest hope. We don't know a lot about him, but perhaps there's something in the name. Bartimaeus means son of the unclean. Unclean was often used as a term for those who suffered from leprosy. We know that Bartimaeus was a beggar. So poor, probably, he just made it from one meal to another. He would be exposed to the weather, heat, cold, rain. He probably didn't have the opportunity to bathe very much, not very sociably acceptable. Perhaps Bartimaeus heard of Jesus healing the blind. There are 6 recorded cases of Jesus healing the blind before we come to this one in Jericho with Bartimaeus. With nothing to lose, he cries out, Son of David. Son of David. But his first cry goes unheard. Sometimes we cry to God from our heads, but not our hearts. Sometimes, if we're all truthful, some prayers have more depth than others. I like the story of the 9-year-old who was asked if his 2-year-old brother had started to talk yet. No, came the reply. Why should he talk? He gets everything he wants by shouting. People didn't want a fuss. They didn't want this popular rabbi disturbed. But Bartimaeus needed to meet Jesus. I think about that crowd, actually, and probably their embarrassment. And in some ways, I think today, you know, it sounds strange, but Christianity doesn't have much to offer the crowd. If we define the crowd as people who prefer to get rather than give, people who believe only in the individual and not the community, if we define the crowd about those who prefer to be served and not to serve, our message today is still not populist. But beware the crowd who want to soften or quieten your voice. One thing we learn from Bartimaeus, he was persistent. And he shouted out again, "Son of David, have mercy on me." There was once a lifeguard who was asked, "How can you tell when someone's in need of help, when there are lots of people on the beach in the water making a tremendous amount of noise?" And he answered, "No matter how great the noise and confusion, there's never been a single time when I could not distinguish the cry of distress above all others." Now, you'd expect me to say this, but I do believe it. In the midst of the babble and the confusion of life, God never fails to hear the soul that cries out to him, "Have mercy on me." This cry is at the heart of the story. And the wonderful thing is we read, Jesus stood still. Let's think about that for a moment. Jesus stood still. The cry of a blind no-hoper stopping in his tracks, the King of Kings. This is Reformation Sunday. We should be glad we have Scripture that tells us these wonderful stories. If you ever wonder whether God hears you, whether your prayers are heard, then revisit this story. Jesus hears most the cries for mercy, the silent, desperate shout which comes from us so often, only when we've come to the end of our tether. Bartimaeus was persistent, he was determined, ushered into Jesus' presence, and the crowd said to him, "Courage." The very people that were trying to quiet him down become his counselors. "Cheer up." And here comes, as C.S. Lewis would put it, the deeper magic in the story. Because I think there is a pattern here that we can learn from. Bartimaeus leaves behind his past. He throws away his cloak, demonstrating he was going to leave his old life. "What do you want me to do?" Jesus asked him. "I want to see." Bartimaeus had a need to be met. He knew what that need was. And NB, nota bene, this, Jesus didn't go to Bartimaeus. Bartimaeus came to Jesus. And of course, maybe from the scientific point of view, we'd like to know what went on, that someone who was blind could see. But you know, all we need to know are contained in the words of Jesus. Thy faith hath made thee whole. And the third and final part of the story, immediately he saw again, having left the past behind, having encountered Jesus, he follows him upon the road. We've talked before, and some of you will remember Helen Adams Keller, the American author, political activist, the first deaf-blind person ever to receive a Bachelor of Arts degree. She has a wonderful story, and amidst all the wonderful things she said about vision was this: the only thing worse than being blind is having sight but no vision. We differ blind and seeing one from another, not in our senses but in the use we make of them. I've walked with people whose eyes are full of light, but who see nothing. I wonder if from time to time I have become blind to the beauty in the world. I wonder if from time to time I've forgotten not your need. I probably know your need for mercy, but I've forgotten my own. I wonder if from time to time I have not had the persistence of Bartimaeus. And I wonder if from time to time I've received a blessing but forgotten to follow the Master. In closing, and you'll be glad I'm not going to sing it, but there is a wonderful song in God's Spell based in a famous prayer. Day by day, O dear Lord, three things I pray: to see thee more clearly, to love thee more dearly, and to follow thee more nearly. And immediately he saw again and followed him on the road. Amen. May God add a blessing to that preaching of his word, to his name the glory and the praise. Now, before we uplift the offering, ladies and gentlemen, I thought I might just share with you, many of you know that I was away, very, very hard work, on a business trip last weekend, into what I would say, very similar to this morning, 4 days of Bavarian autumnal heaven. Oberammergau, I can tell you, and many of you already knew this, is a stunning village, known for a variety of things. 1634, they put on their first passion play. But it's not just the passion play that makes Oberammergau. There are wood carvers, there are painted murals. In 2020, we hope, God willing, we'll have 45 leave the parish here for a visit there, already signed up. I have to say, we will need a miracle to get out of Munich Airport together. It is an absolute maze. It's a huge airport. But what I wanted to share with you is there is much to look forward to. We were blessed to speak to some of the cast, and the reason we were there was that they were casting the play. So the village met in the church where they keep this vow And the whole village went down to the theatre and then they wrote up the cast. But I close with this little thought, which is as appropriate for ourselves here as those in Oberammergau. The people on the play said this: what brings us together is the story. And I think, not just for the travellers, God willing, that will go in 2020, but for ourselves here, different people, different ages and stages in life, what brings us together is his story. So, as we uplift the offering, enjoy, if you can, just a little Bavarian autumnal heaven. Your offering will now be received. Let us pray. Lord God, giver of all that is good, in response to your generosity, we bring you these, our offerings, only as a token. Take them, use them, take us, use us. In the furtherance of your kingdom here on earth, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We close our worship singing together a hymn called Jesus Have Mercy. The tune is Morning Has Broken. And then following the benediction, our little postlude, Shalom, My Friend. So go in peace, be watchful for his kingdom, and may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all and those whom you love, now and forevermore.